The views of this program are not necessarily the views of KJLL Radio, its management, or its sponsors. The host is solely responsible for its content. Enjoy!
On a mission given to me by Woody Shaw, Sunship, Dizzy, and Billy Higgins, dedicated to pursuing a piece of our cultural heritage through interviews with my jazz heroes, this is the Jake Feinberg Show. Welcome, everybody, inside the studios of KJLL 1330, The Jolt. This is the Jake Feinberg Show. It's great to have you all here. My guest today has encompassed the entire spectrum of music, soul funk, blues, jazz, world music, and he's done it on two instruments, the lead electric guitar and the lead electric bass. He was born in Chicago and fell right in as the lead session player at Chess Records, where he played with Muddy Waters and Howlin' Wolf. He was part of the psychedelic rock collective Rotary Connection with Minnie Riperton. His generation was that of Clyde Stubblefield and Arthur Adams. He made his own albums on Cadet and Blue Thumb under Tommy LaPuma, as well as the Kudu label. It's an honor today to introduce Phil Upchurch to the Jake Feinberg program.
How you doing, Jay?
How's it going, my friend?
Oh, man, I'm having the ball, actually.
So am I. So am I, man, and it's about 114 in Tucson, but my brain tends to boil when it gets that hot, and I didn't think I'd be able to get you on the show as quickly as I did, but it's an honor to have you here, and I'm glad you're in good spirits.
Well, it's an honor for me to be doing this. You know, every time you see your name in print or hear a record on the radio or you know, something like this happens, it's like it's for the very first time in your life that it happens, and you forget about all the other times that it happened, and it's always very exciting.
Absolutely. I mean, I saw you, to put things in perspective for my audience, I was at Boston University back maybe my sophomore year, and you were playing with Jimmy Smith at the House of Blues in Boston, and I remember just, I heard your last name, and I loved it so much. The whole night I was just calling out, Upchurch! Just yelling, and you kind of gave this like this quizzical look, like who is this? What's going on? But it was such a great show, and Jimmy played so strong that night. It was a beautiful band. So I saw you then. Fast forward about 12 years, and here we are. So let's do it.
All right.
Yeah, Phil, you were born in Chicago, and I really was hoping you could take us inside the Upchurch house growing up. Were your parents very involved in your life? Did you go to church? What kind of lifestyle did you have? Did you struggle putting food on the table? What was your upbringing like?
Well, a lot of fun. I had two sisters who used to brow, two older sisters. They made me wash dishes. They made me do the chores around the house that they didn't want to do. But other than that, we had a very loving relationship. And we were a great family, close-knit. I can recall some of my earliest memories when it would get hot before air conditioning. Most people didn't have air conditioning. It would still be 90 degrees at night. And my dad would take us down to the lakefront in Chicago, and we actually spend the night out in the open down there, which is something you can't even think about doing
never,
these days.
Never now, yeah.
So those are some of my earliest memories, and my father was always very supportive. He bought me my first instrument, ukulele, and then later on down the line, he noticed that I was watching the Les Paul and Mary Ford show, which were, you know, a couple that played the guitar and sang together. And said, he think he can handle the guitar. And I just told him, yeah, whether I thought I could or not. But I did realize that the guitar only had two additional strings than the ukulele, but other than that, it was tuned the same.
Exactly.
So I said, sure, you know, cool. And then he got me lessons downtown. I remember Lion and Hilly downtown. And I would go in, and the teachers marveled at what I was playing naturally. And this was when I was in, you know, I would say around 16, 17 years old. So I told myself, well, what do I need to come down here to school for? And I'm already past these guys. They're talking about, wow, we wish we could play like you. I said, I don't need you guys. So I just, you know, scooted out on my own.
So you were.
Learned as I went.
Yeah, Phil, let's talk about that. Because at the beginning, you know, when. For me, you know, I collect a lot of vinyl records. I barely collect CDs at all. And every time I see you on one of these albums, it could be like a blues album on Cadet, or then I look at Donny Hathaway live, and then you're playing electric lead on Donny, and then I'm like, wait, did I see him? He was playing bass? I said, this is insane. I was telling, you know, the guys that know what's going on, I'm like, there's nobody else like Phil Upchurch out there. I mean, was there anybody else that you came across in your peer group, or even before that did that kind of concept, the lead electric and the lead bass, as proficiently as you did?
There was only one that I can recall at the moment. Well, there's two. Ironically, probably a lot of people don't know, but Eric Gale played great bass.
Oh my God, I didn't know that.
Yeah, and then there was a guy in Chicago named Reggie Boyd. And I guess this was around the late 50s. There was a big hit out of Vibrations. I can't remember the name of it, and Reggie Boyd played the bass on there, the Watusi out of Vibrations.
The Watusi?
Yeah.
Wow.
It was back in the late 50s, early 60s.
Gail was in New York, though. Is that right? He was on the East Coast, and you were in the Midwest. Is that how did you guys?
Exactly.
Go ahead. How did you? Go ahead. Tell me how you guys how'd you follow each other? Did you just meet each other at gigs and things like that?
No, he was stationary on the East Coast doing dates, and I was basically I was doing dates in Chicago mostly. And the first time I actually recall meeting him. Was I went to Kudu Records to do the Tennyson Upchurch record, and he was playing guitar on that record, if I recall correctly, and that would have been my first encounter with Eric.
That's such a great story.
We knew about each other, you know. A lot of guys know about each other from seeing the names on records, you know.
That's such a great story, because that was your first album for the Creed Taylor Kudu label, and you guys have been doing it for so long, and then you finally got to meet, you know.
Yeah.
And that's a cool overlap. In any event, it's sometimes I feel like my eyes are deceiving me, but I know they're not. And I wanted to know, in your mind, in that mid to late 40s period when you were growing up, talk a little bit about how the blues had evolved at that point. What were you listening to? And why was it all centered in that Midwestern bastion there?
Number one, the guys were coming up the Delta, up the Mississippi River, and I don't understand why St. Louis didn't become, you know, that kind of a blues center.
It might have been more racist than Chicago.
But the guys, yeah, exactly. So the guys, you know, the further north they could get, the better off they
exactly.
were. Yeah, you're exactly right about that. So they came to Chicago seeking greater opportunities, and the Delta Blues came with them. And so the first music I heard around the house was Nat King Cole Trio records that I can recall, which has probably got a lot to do with my diversity in terms of, you know, rhythm and blues and jazz. My father also played piano in a jazz band, so I'd hear him playing songs that, you know, some of the chords were somewhat complex, and so having those nailed in my brain from an early age. But the blues really caught my attention. The Delta Blues, the guys on Dobro's, and we used to shop in an area called Maxwell Street in Chicago, which was very famous. And that's where a lot of the blues players, blind guys with tin cups, would just sit out on the street playing and singing. And naturally, you know, I would hear the blues on the radio, you know, all the time. My parents didn't play the blues, but you hear blues wherever you went. So that became deeply ingrained in my spirit.
How early did you see, when you were walking in Maxwell shopping, there'd just be guys with cups that had no vision. They were playing and singing. How young were you? How impressionable were you at that point?
Let me see. I would say maybe far back as I remember, we shopped there because those were the best bargains in the city.
Mm-hmm.
So as far back as I can remember, from the time I started in grade school, which would have been 5 years old, that's where, you know, most black people shopped because it was closed. It was like a 15-minute bus ride from the west side where I was, and it was the best bargains in town. So it would be equivalent in today's money being able to buy five pair of socks for a dollar.
Right.
You know.
No, the guys I talked to the drummer, Carl Burnett, and I talked to a bunch of other guys, and they talk about the neighborhoods. Especially in Southern California, it was before desegregation. The neighborhoods were still segregated, and in some ways, it made the communities much more tight knit because you knew that if you cut up, if you screwed up, you'd probably get whipped by the neighbors three times before you even got home to see your folks. And it seemed to me that, and it wasn't just about the whipping is really the insignificant part. The point is that families cared for other kids. They looked out for each other, and there was a lot more trust within the communities, which is leading to my question is, because of that trust, is that where the Phil Upchurches and the Donny Hathaways and the Curtis Mayfields, the idea that they sing about so much love and so much beautiful stuff, it came from those neighborhoods. Am I wrong or right?
I would say exactly that. And, you know, in families, you know, there wasn't as much stress, you know, financially, because actually people were doing better than they had been doing previously, and they were doing better than their parents had been doing. So, you know, kids have no idea, even if they're disadvantaged or a little poor, they have no idea about that. You don't think about money. All you think about is school, you know, yuck, school and playing. You know, that's all we're doing is playing and stuff. And so... there was a lot of, you know, love within the family and between the neighbors. I don't recall ever, you know, having, you know, hassles with the neighbor. This neighbor doesn't like that neighbor and that kind of stuff. I like it is today where people don't even know their next door neighbor.
I know. I mean, I live in a community where I don't, you know, and I don't know my neighbors, and it's not like I'm, you know, I don't need to do that, but it would be nice once in a while for, it just breeds trust, and you're more willing to engage and hence collaborate. And then all of a sudden you're doing non-spoken sensory stuff like playing music, you know, like,
yeah.
You know, I mean, different sensors, you know, auditory, tactual, you know, so talk, I really want to know, there's just so many questions, but, you know, take us through being the house guitar player at Chess. I mean, how did that work? They said, oh, by the way, we need you twice this week. Here are the charts. Or was it just the situation where you knew everybody in the stable and you were coming and meeting with them and you were just jamming? Can you please, for the audience, this is a very special and important part of music. So if you could articulate that Chess Records label as the house guitar player, it'd be great.
Well, we worked on a salary plus a certain amount of money for each side, you know, each song that we played on. So we'd come to work, I can't remember, maybe about noon, we'd show up and they had a section for songwriters. And they were always writing songs, and the musicians would show up, you know, every day, and we'd work with the songwriters, putting the songs together. You know, like I said, we were on salary.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we did. And we would make demos with the songwriters. And then the demos would be taken to the A&R department, artists and repertoire, you know, the guy that picks out what's going to be recorded for the different artists. And once the songs passed their judgment, once they decided what songs were going to be recorded, then we go on the other side of the building into the studios, and we would, you know, record the tunes.
Hmm. Interesting.
They would pick tunes, writing for different artists, and that's pretty much how it worked out. You know, I remember, like, say, for example, Little Milton, he'd come into Donny, he would have already gotten with, you know, the producer, conductor of the session, which was generally a musician, like, say, Gene Barge, and they would come in with their charts. And we go in and just do the albums like that, you know, three songs for a three-hour session. And that's how that would work out. Minnie Riperton, when I first came to Chess out of the Army in 67, she was receptionist.
Wow.
And she was doing background work.
Holy cow. Okay.
She was a background singer. And she had this 5-octave range, and Charles Stepney, you know, realized the talent. And he talked to, you know, to Chet Leonard and Field into doing a solo album on her. And, you know, boom, that was the end of that.
Boom, I mean, right there.
Skyrocketed.
Holy,
yeah.
That's a great wow, that just blew my mind, that story. That's unbelievable. So you were salaried. What was the union? How strong were the unions? Was there a black union and a white union, or when was it segregated, or was it together?
Well, there were two unions, and, you know, black union, white union. But at Chess, the union people couldn't come in and oversee what was going on. So we didn't have to worry about them. When I did outside dates, you know, with other artists, the union guy would come in, and he had a card that said the MF from the union. So nobody wanted to see him, you know.
Right.
But he stayed there during the whole session to make sure, you know, overtime, doubling, and all those kind of things went down the way they were supposed to go down, you know.
Right. Now, I'm just wondering if it afforded you, you know, what was healthcare like? Was healthcare so... Was it not nearly the cost? I'm just trying to figure out what unions, as opposed to what unions are meant for today, which is sort of supporting workers' rights and health care and retirement and stuff. What was the incentive at that point? Or was it even clear?
Well, no. If you were a member of the unions, they were part of the American Federation.
Workers.
Same thing as any other. Yeah, workers. So money was taken out of our money if we were on union contracts. You know, for health and welfare and social security. But unfortunately for us, most of the sessions, or quite a few of them, we didn't file union contracts.
Mm.
So that was a little bit unfortunate. And of course, we weren't businessmen, you know.
Exactly.
We always say, if I had known, I would have demanded contracts on everything, you know, so would everybody else.
Exactly.
But, you know, it's life.
Can you, at that time, you're like someone like Muddy Waters or Howlin' Wolf, they would play the song, they'd play, like you said, you'd do a whole set list or whatever, and then the A&R guy would figure out which ones were gonna go to the record, and then you'd go in and cut the record. Would the actual lead artist, was there ever any fisticuffs over that, or were they just...
Never. The only time there was a row in the studio, I remember we were doing a session with the Dales.
Right.
And Bobby Miller was the producer and writer of their hits. And Phil Chess came into the studio and started making suggestions to Bobby Miller, the producer writer.
Mm-hmm.
He grabbed Phil by the shoulder, spun him around, opened the door, and said, "Get out and stay out."
Oh, my gosh.
I couldn't believe it. I said, man, he put the owner of the company out of the studio.
He spun him on his head.
Yeah, he said, "Get out and stay out." And Phil just laughed and shrugged his shoulders, you know.
But they knew what they were doing, and they didn't want any middlemen to come in and bust it up, you know.
Oh, no, it was just fun, man, big time fun. Look forward to going to work every day, and Jeff, they owned their own radio station. They had their own pressing plant. We'd do a session in the morning, and on the way home from work, we'd hear it on the radio.
Wow. I mean, the ability and the freedom and the accessibility of the was it on AM radio? Was it an AM station?
Yeah.
It's like the advent of just the lack of monopoly, the lack of corporatization of those radio stations freed them up so that you could hear this huge, diverse wave of music, all this fusion of, you know, early blues and R&B and soul and pop. Like, it was all put together and it was made accessible via the radio.
Yeah.
We're talking to Phil Upchurch, legendary musician from Chicago. Before we take a break at the bottom of the hour, Phil, I wanted to talk to you about this. I'm curious about the generation of players that you were coming up with. The Arthur Adams, the Morris Jennings. What did you guys stand for? What were your philosophies on governing your own life and the life of music?
Man, we didn't give it any thought. We just go in and groove and play.
But it takes it takes a supreme amount of confidence and security to do that on a consistent basis, because it's easy to lose your edge. You guys didn't lose your edge. So what was the character? What were some of the things that defined the character? Was it the army? What was it?
Well, the music defined everything, and the music was fun, and we were working with, you know, the top people in the business. So it was always fun, man. No game, but just always fun. And music, it's the music that ruled everything. We were working with the best. We were working with the best of the best. And we were the best of the best. So, but we never looked at it quite that way. We would just go to the studio and do some sessions, and it was a blast, you know.
Can you talk about your relationship with Morris Jennings? You did a lot of work with him at that time.
When I came in, Morris Jennings had a part-time job at the post office. Okay?
Yeah.
And he had a shift where, you know, he had a night shift. And he could come in the afternoon and do dates. And one day I went up to Morris.
You know, Phil, you know what? I don't want to rush this story. I want it to be good. I know it's going to be good. And we're going to take a break to go to the news break. And when we come back, we'll pick up on that story. Is that okay?
No problem.
All right, man. Hang tight. This is the Jake Feinberg Show. We're talking to Phil Upchurch. And just remember that as this journey continues, more and more doors will open as they have continued to open. And as I walk through to this cosmic journey of discovering all my heroes and legends of this generation of music. We're going to take a short break, and we'll be back in just a little bit.
Let's do it.
This is Tucson's Jolt.
It's strange and wonderful.
You have a firm grasp of the obvious.
KJLL, South Tucson.
CNN Radio Special Report. I'm Stan Case. Emergency officials now blame Hurricane Irene for at least 6 deaths, 3 in North Carolina, 2 in Virginia, and 1 in Florida. North Carolina Governor Bev Perdue details some of the damage in her state.
We have had reports of possible tornadoes that struck last night in 3 counties, with some minor injuries reported in Tyrrell County, along with structural damage to several homes.
Irene is hammering Virginia now, and its effects are being felt in Washington. Mayor Vincent Gray says they're ready for the storm.
We're expecting anywhere from 2 to 4 inches of rain. We're expecting high winds, and we certainly could have some power outages, but all of our staff is mobilized at our emergency operations center, and we are ready for this.
Irene is expected to reach New York overnight tonight. This is a special report from CNN Radio.
Buying a good used car is all about having the right information and facts. And if it's a Honda certified used car, well, it just got a whole lot easier. Because now you can find out the history, mileage, and the price of the Honda you're looking for without leaving your home. Simply go online and search Google or Yahoo for Honda certified used cars. You'll see the current selection at the Honda dealers nearest you, along with the information you need to make the right choice. Honda certified used cars. It may be used, but it's still a Honda.
I used to be that guy you'd see riding a big old bike down the highway. Man, I loved that. Don't have that bike anymore. Sold it when I lost my license for riding drunk. You may still see me, though. Now I'm the guy picking up trash, wearing a fluorescent vest that says community service.
Cops are cracking down on drinking and riding all across the country. And they'll see you before you see them. Ride sober or get pulled over.
The Home Depot guarantees that you pay the lowest total price on carpet, pad, and installation. Plus, you can get special financing. So you get the beautiful new carpet you've been waiting for, you get lifetime stain and installation warranties, and you save money every step of the way. So, bottom line, you won't find a better bottom line anywhere else with the lowest total price on carpet, pad, and installation guaranteed. More saving, more doing. That's the power of the Home Depot. U.S. only. See store for details.
Live from Progressive.
Flo here. Let's take another question.
Hi, Flo. I saved a ton of money with Progressive's discounts.
Great, but that's not really a question.
Oh, you're right. I saved a ton of money with Progressive's discounts?
Still not quite right, but you get the idea. Progressive makes it easy to save.
Right.
Discounts for safe driving, owning a home, and more. Now that's Progressive. Call or click today.
Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and its affiliates, Mayfield Village, Ohio. Prices vary based on how you buy. Discounts not available in all states or situations.
Folks, this is Jake Feinberg. One of the first things I wanted to do when I moved to Tucson was find authentic Chinese cuisine. After a tip from the Chinese Student Association, I headed over to Badar Chinese Restaurant. Well, it's been 7 years, and I have never looked back. Located at 7321 East Broadway Boulevard, Badar has been a family-run operation since 1992. The award-winning chef produces succulent dishes from sizzling ginger chicken to salt and pepper shrimp. The thing that separates Badar from the rest is that the chef procures ancient oriental dishes with the exotic island flair of Taiwan. Most importantly, there are no gimmicks or razzle-dazzle at Badar. You won't find any flat-screen TVs or karaoke machines. Badar is a place to go enjoy good food and spend time with your family. It exudes peace and tranquility after a long week of work. So come down and check out Badar Chinese Restaurant. Hong Hao Chu. It's that good. Folks, this is Jake Feinberg. As a passionate consumer of vinyl records, I value the art of collecting and archiving. So I have marked my calendar for Sunday, November 6th for the 7th annual Tucson Record Show, located at Las Casuitas Event Center at I-10 and Grant. The show features vinyl collectors and dealers from all over the state. Doors open at 9 a.m. and tables are available for rent, but space is running out fast. For more information, contact Bruce Smith at 622-0104. The 7th Annual Tucson Record Show, 1365 West Grant and I-10, Sunday, November 7th. It's time to dig and get dirty. Don't miss it. If you're not part of the solution, you're part of the problem. Be a part of a new coalition with Jake Feinberg. The second half of my show starts right now. Welcome back, everybody. Deep in the heart of Chicago, although he's in Los Angeles today, I'm joined by legendary bass and guitar player Phil Upchurch. Phil, welcome back, my friend.
Hey, man. What's going on?
You tell me, man. Talk. Give me a story about Morris and the post office.
Yeah, Morris was working part-time at the post office. And one day I said, well, Morris, why don't you, you know, let go of the post office? He said, man, you know, I need that security and that money. I said, man, you got security right here at Chess. What's up? I said, and then you, plus you need to remember something. We tend to wherever we put our energies, then that's where, you know, our stuff bounces back at us.
Exactly.
I said, so you got to be careful where you put your energy, man. I said, because as long as part of your energy is there, then, you know, that's probably going to be the outcome. You know, wherever you put your seed, that's where, you know, your fruit grows.
Exactly.
So,
great line.
So, he listened to me. He took it into consideration. I said, try it for a month and see what happens. So, he tried it for a while. He took a leave of absence. And he said, oh, man, you were right. He said, I make more money than I was making at the post office because I quit the post office.
And he was starting to follow his passion.
Yeah. We are having a bit of a problem here.
What's going on? Let's work through it.
I think I can hear you okay now.
Okay, good. Go ahead. So you were, the point was he was going to settle for security over interest and love. And you said, go with the interest and love and soon that will turn into security.
Yeah. That's basically what I told him. You know, I tell people all the time, be careful where you put your energy because that's where your fruit is going to grow. So a lot of times you just have to be diligent and pray. And just know, you know, the power of positive thinking.
You know, I wanted to ask you, it's one of those things where maybe if you were playing through it, it's harder to analyze. But the period of time that when I first discovered you was the early 70s. And it was this situation where musicians started to be heavily influenced by acid rock, psychedelic flavor. And they were incorporating that with the blues and Latin. And even guys like Howlin' Wolf and Muddy and Bo Diddley, they were much more, there was more of an emphasis on wah-wah guitars, bass lines that provided the funky backbeat. How do you explain this evolution of the blues?
Well, the evolution of the music has a lot to do with the evolution of the instruments. So as the instrument become more electronic, then you know, it's definitely going to play a part in, you know, swinging the sound of the music. And we also have to remember the generation gap every 10 years, you know, so along with the technology, the music changes. And now I listen to the music the kids are playing, and I'm going, I don't understand it.
Can you talk about
you know,
that?
It's the same as our parents, you know, were talking about our music when we were young.
Oh, I see. Okay,
you know,
okay.
It's the same thing, the generation gap. So it's a lot of times it's hard to get a grasp, you know, on the latest, you know, musical fads and whatnot. But, you know, because a guy like Ray Charles, for example, you know, when they tried to get him into synthesizers and whatnot, you know, it was a problem for him. And then you turn around and look at a Herbie Hancock, who's always, you know, wide open for changes. Wide open. So it's just two different concepts. Muddy Waters and the electric albums we did on those guys at Chess, they were opposed to the idea.
They were?
Yeah, they didn't like it at all. It wasn't their idea.
So it was really... Exactly.
The record companies and the producers, specifically Charles Stepney. He said, man, no, we gotta get with the hippies, man. And you know, and sure enough, the Electric Mud album, you know, I was on the north side of Chicago once, and I seen, you know, the long-haired hippie walking down the street with the Electric Mud under his arm. Now, I doubt seriously if any of Muddy's traditional blues albums would have been under that guy's arms, you know?
Exactly. No, it's so, yeah. I'm so glad you brought that up. Because you know what? You know, I'm 33 years old. So I was born way before any of this music was ever even born or even created. And yet you look at you look at online record shops and the albums that are most appealing to not appealing is the wrong word, but the most tripped out ones are like Electric Mud. I mean, that album is an incredible experimentation in it's a veering way away from your straight ahead blues, and it's going into some sort of psychedelic fury. I mean, that blows the roof off the place. But it's funny, you know, it must have been at the time really interesting to see, you know, Stepney basically saying, listen, you know, these guys, you know, they've taken a ton of acid. They want to hear but I just am trying to figure out what it meant, more like wah-wah. Did you actually like playing that? It sounded to me like you liked that kind of, like when you, the song on Love and Feeling on Blue Thumb, you do this song called Sitar Soul.
Oh, yeah.
And you're making
I'm just sitting here looking at that sitar right now.
Yeah, I put it, I mean, it's ridiculous. It's like I throw that out, you know, my daughter and I will have a dance party to that. You know, it's like you're just, it was an experimental time, and people are like, oh, yeah, you know, it was all this happy, you know, hippie music. No, it wasn't. It was bad. There was an edge to it, and it was really funky, and it just seemed to me that, and I can't figure out if it was like, you know, a sign of the times, whether you guys knew that maybe the industry was changing really quickly and you had to lay it all out there, because, I mean, a few years later, the sound was different than it was in, you know, that early 70s period.
Yeah. Yeah, things, like I say, things change every 10 or so years, you know, basically.
What do you hear now? What are you playing now that soothes your soul these days?
I'm writing for my next project, and I've never did that. My wife encouraged me. She said, quit playing other people's music. Play your own music.
Right on.
If I had done that from the very beginning, life would be a lot different. So consequently, for the last...
You're saying you would have made more money.
Well, probably, but I would have been more of a Phil Upchurch, you know, instead of, you know, a supporter. I would, you know, having my own band and writing my own music, I would have had my own signature.
Yeah, but Phil, let me tell you something. That might be true, but at the same time, the idea that that on your album Darkness, Darkness, you had Chuck Rainey and Arthur Adams on that album. You were a head player. You were a headhunter, and you know, woulda, shoulda, coulda. You know, you said it earlier. People always say, if I had just done that. Whatever. Mm-hmm. Your path was your path.
Yeah.
And you carved it out, man. You know, and if you, and listen, as far as I'm concerned, maybe you're going through another growth spurt right now, and you know, you'll become a prolific writer, but you know, I wouldn't judge it off that. I mean, you're cemented, your legacy is cemented as an accompanist, because the music and the time that you grew up in catered to that. Now it caters to the individual, and it's not nearly as substantive, and it's not nearly as wholesome. So I think you should also be thankful for the time that you grew up in. But I'm not gonna lecture you today. Basically,
I actually don't have any regrets. But given the chance to do it again, I would say I would do like George Benson did when Miles approached him. George said, "No thanks, I got my own thing to do." It's like I said, where you plant your seeds, that's where your flowers grow.
Right. You're able to...
So if I had been more single-minded about what I was doing and carving out my own career, just being a supporting player. But the thing about it is, that's what I wanted to do, was to be a supporting player. I can remember, you know, seeing different guys. I, you know, go to a session, for example, and Ramsey Lewis is in there playing, and we didn't even know each other that well at that time. And I say, man, if I could get those guys respect and play with those guys, so that's where my energy was. I never dreamed in a million years that Jimmy Smith would be calling me for a gig, to give me a gig. I never dreamed in a zillion years. In 58, when I was walking down the street and heard the Champ come on the radio, it was a new sound. And I buy all his records and jam with him, but I never thought in a zillion years I'd ever be part of this regular band. But that was the thing I wanted to do in my head, where that energy was. And I played all his records, I buy them and I jam with the records. So when I finally got the opportunity to play with him, you know, the guitar player said, hey, man, let this kid play, he can really play.
Mm-hmm.
I said, man, I can't play with no Jimmy Smith, are you out of your mind? He said, no, man, go ahead. Quinn Warren from Washington, D.C. So he said, come on and sit in, Jimmy will let you play. I went up there shivering and shaking, you know, and Jimmy would look at me and he'd play He'd go off harmonically someplace. I look at him, and I go right there. He couldn't lose me. Blew his mind. I blew Jimmy Smith's mind. I couldn't believe he couldn't lose me.
Yeah, well, and that...
So
and
it,
that,
it paid off, you know.
Yeah, I mean, you know, you're... It's a testament to, I also think it's really classic because there's, it gives me an opportunity to throw on songs like the one I'm about to and tease people because they'll say, who's playing bass on that album? Say it's Phil Upchurch. And then all of a sudden people start, it's kind of like this discovery. It's the thrill of the pursuit. And as far as I'm concerned, this is a classic example of you laying it down. And we're going to listen to it through and then come back and talk about this track, all right?
Okay.
All right, now. Laying it down, Phil Upchurch. So you did you peg that one?
Ben Sidran, huh?
Oh, you got it, brother. I'll tell you, that's tough. I mean, you and Stubblefield are on fire. I mean, it's beyond love, man. It's beyond.
What album is that on?
It's on Don't Let Go.
Don't Let Go.
It's on Blue Thumb. And, you know... it's one of those things where you just it's foot tapping, knee slapping, boogie down music, and and it almost sounded to me like what the companies were trying to do at that time with Ben was really turn him into sort of a you know, retrofitted early '70s version of Mose Allison. You know, I heard that kind of stuff, but then they just said, we need to put a killer rhythm section in there. And did you play the lead guitar licks on that too, or just bass?
No, that was a guy named Curly. I don't remember his last name.
Curly.
And I'm pretty sure that was his song too.
Wow. Yeah, and you know, for the life of me, I can't remember the name of that track. It was just bumping. It's in my car, and the roof's coming off every time you play a low end bass line. You know, the rear view mirror just shakes.
Well, you know, one of the biggest influences on my playing was the bass on Respect by Aretha Franklin.
And who was on that?
You know, probably Chuck Rainey.
Right.
I would have to say that he was very influential to me as a bass player. Sure, you know.
What was he doing technically that you got off on?
Well, that's his style and his feel. You know, it's like Jameson. You know, Motown, he had a thing that, you know, nobody else had. And it was just his feel.
You know,
a lot of the arrangers, they wouldn't write notes, they'd write chord changes. You know, you're going to play some stuff I'd never be able to write.
Exactly.
And half the time, I even find myself doing the same thing. I'll write out a bass line for one of my arrangements for the band, and a lot of times I'll tell a man, scratch out all those notes and go for it.
Yeah, let the music take your mind, right?
Yeah.
Oh, I dig that. That's so well said. I don't think I've ever heard anybody talk like that.
Yeah.
You know, through all the musical. Can you, you know, one of the guys that I feel is never talked about, I mean, he's very well known, but he died so young, is Donny Hathaway. And he seemed, from what I've read and talked to, and I've never talked to anybody who intimately knew him, but he was a really sentimental, very sensitive cat, and could never really find his way out. But yet, I'm not moved by anybody more than him, man. I know you played with him, and I was hoping you could talk about that band and who he was as much as you knew him.
I didn't work with Curtis regularly, Mayfield, but he called me once to come out to California with him. He said, "We're just going for one night." And I met Donnie, and I heard him playing, and I'm going, phew, oh, my God. And I said, Donnie, you need to come to Chicago. He was living in St. Louis at RDC, I forget which. I said, you need to move to Chicago, man. He said, you think I can get some work?
Oh, he's hard up for work. That's unbelievable.
No, he wasn't hard up. Yeah. I mean, he always worked, but he said, you think I can get some work in Chicago? I think I can get some gigs?
You're like, yeah, it won't be a problem.
I said, I tell you what, I'm going to put a band together. I didn't even have a band. I said, I'm going to put a band together.
Oh, wow.
Yourself and myself. And I threw a band together just so I could play with him, you know. And I played. He played. I introduced him to the keyboard bass. He came to my little recording studio, and he saw this piano bass. It's like a 2 octaves. You know, the lower end.
Mm-hmm.
He said, what's that little half a piano over there? I said, oh, that's a keyboard bass. And he tried it out, and he fell in love with it.
Wow.
He's using it on the ghetto and a lot of his hits. And in my band, he would play that. And then to give him a chance to play some good old two-fisted piano, I would switch over and play the bass on a lot of the tunes. So it was a very ideal situation for me. And the rest is history, but he was definitely a shy guy. You know, he wasn't the kind of guy that, you know, very laid back. He wasn't in love with himself at all.
I love that. You know, see, these are the people when I hear him sing, though, I mean, he just pours everything into it, and it's such righteous music, and I'm just curious, did he pass when you guys were still playing together?
Oh, no. That's long after that.
Long after that.
Yeah.
I have, we're in our final 5 minutes with the man, Phil Upchurch. And, Phil, just for the record, Monk Montgomery was the first person to use the bass in an electric fashion. Is that true?
I'm sure that he was one of the first that got any recognition for it, you know, with the Montgomery brothers. It's a possibility that Dizzy Gillespie might have been. but we can always go to Google.
Dizzy, what do you mean, Dizzy Gillespie?
The trumpet player, Dizzy Gillespie.
Electric bass? Dizzy was the first one to do that?
He might have been.
Oh, you get out of town. Get out of here.
Dizzy was very, you know, experimental, so to speak.
No, believe me.
Don't take my word, but.
Listen, Phil, you don't know this.
Monk Montgomery was one of the first known for it, especially in jazz.
Well, what I was going to tell you is that, Dizzy, you haven't seen my archives yet, but I've interviewed Al Gaffa, his guitar player, Mike Longo, Mickey Roker.
Oh, okay.
Mickey Roker. I interviewed his whole early 70s band, and
okay.
They said, you know, there's a reason they call him Dizzy. You know, there was a reason, because
that's
he
it.
Would do bizarre stuff. And for you to say that, I will now have to do some digging, because it wouldn't surprise me. And I feel like he's very much his soul is inside of me as he pushes me along on this journey that I'm on. And I'm happy for it, because that dude didn't look at life straight ahead. He looked at all the beauties and the contours of the angles, left, right, you know, he was all out there. And
yeah, I played with this electric bass.
Well, what I wanted that, you know, as we wrap up here, I said, Phil was on Perception. In 1970, you were on that Dizzy album with James Moody and Mike Longo, The Real Thing, it was called.
See, I don't even remember that.
That
playing electric bass?
I mean, that was when Dizzy was doing his electric stuff. But tell me.
I don't remember making a record with Dizzy. I remember playing with him at the London House, though, in Chicago.
All right, well, I'll tell you something. I'll do some research on that, because I'd like to get an album to you that you did play electric bass on with Dizzy. I don't own that album particularly, but it does credit you as the electric bass player in that album.
Okay, and what's the name of the album?
The name of the album is called The Real Thing.
Hmm.
On Perception from 1970. I was actually did you get a chance to, flexible enough in your schedule where you could wind up in New York sometimes and you'd maybe on a tour, or you were cutting a record and you'd wind up with some of those East Coast jazz cats like the, you know, the Ron Carters or the James Moody's or the Dizzy's? I mean, how did you wind up with those guys?
With Diz, it was just probably by, you know, reputation. Everybody kind of knows about everybody else, you know, the good guys. I met Ron Carter, of course, doing my, doing the George Benson record, Bad Benson. When I met Ron actually played my bass on one of the songs.
Wow. What song is that?
He did, yeah. I don't recall at this time, but I have a picture of him playing my bass. Maybe he was just noodling around. I don't know.
Hey, I want to, in our remaining minute, Phil, I want you to talk a little bit about what you're up to these days, the band you're playing with, and where people can go see you.
I'm playing in various venues, no place regularly. And my wife is producing my next record, Sonya, and some of the songs we wrote together. But 99% of my energy now is spent on composing for my next album.
Well, Phil Upchurch, I just wanted to tell you, it was better than I ever could have dreamed, and you know, I hope you will stay with me as I continue this journey through my heroes of jazz. Thank you so much for being part of the program, my friend.
Well, thank you for the invitation, Jake.
All right,
thank
man.
You.
Take it easy. We'll see you next week.
Okay, man.
All right, buddy.
KJLL, South Tucson.
CBS News, I'm Gary Nahn. Irene, which slammed North Carolina's Outer Banks this morning, continues its rampage, taking aim and making a beeline for the New York City area.